So where are we going?
We are going to Rwanda.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm very excited.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. I'm packed.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like it's going to be life-changing, and I just can't wait to see how. This is obviously the hardest part about going to on a trip like this is leaving these guys.
Yep.
Why can't you go to Africa? Because, well, first of all, Mama had to get 6 shots, and I had to get 6 shots in my arms, and it's kind of hard work to go to Africa.
I've got 2 sweet boys. Kirby is 5. Toby is 2. And my husband, Troy, and we met in college, got married right out of school, and have been just celebrated 11 years. Troy likes to say, if somebody asks him, how long have you been married? He says, we've been happily married for 9 years. We've been married for 11.
Little girl, tie on your angel wings and fly, fly, fly. Far away until you fall asleep. Oh, fly, 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 fly. Fly into the place you see the sun is setting. Fly into the land of ever after endings. Fly until you come upon love I am sending. The morning will.
Kirby, this is a highlight of my year right here. See, at the fair, you can eat cookies before you eat your lunch. Thank you. Oh, thank you, bud. You have to double fist it. Oh, my God. Hot and fresh, baby. Look at how pretty this sky is. Look at that. He is 1,040 pounds. He's hungry. You're cute with your oinky ears on.
And I just showed up for my own life.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing from Minneapolis, Minnesota, Sara
went back to Rwanda a year after the genocide, which has been about 10 years ago, and he investigated the history, basically asking the question, how can something like this happen? And it's an incredible book because it brings so much value to the story on both sides, understanding their histories and their struggles, their misunderstanding of history, and it's really an incredible book. The Rwandans say evil has had its day, but that they have really moved on, and in 10 years they've made incredible gains to become one nation and to not be divided by ethnicity. This is really great to know as we're going in. I saw the sunrise in Belgium and I saw it set over Africa. So sunset probably an hour and a half ago, and now we're landing in Kigali, and just glad to be on the ground. It's been a lot of sitting in the airplane time. In school and been in choirs and madrigals, and I had done like cover songs and like for a skit at school, things like that. But to share my own music was always very tense for me. And Troy tricked me one time when we were dating. I came home to visit him in Minnesota, and he said, your favorite singer is going to sing at church on Sunday. It was over Thanksgiving, I think. And I asked him the whole ride. I kept saying, well, who's going to be at your church this Sunday? And he wouldn't tell me. And then I think it's when we got to his house, he said, by the way, the special singer this Sunday is you. So I don't remember if I was mad, or I think I was mad at first. And then I was just a nervous wreck.
I'd like to welcome to the stage our good friend Steve Mason from Jars of Clay. He was in shorts earlier and assured me that he would dress up for my set tonight. Thank you, Steve. You look very put together.
It's written on our hearts, written on our souls.
Right out of school, we were both doing different jobs. I was a Kelly temporary first, which was actually one of my all-time favorite jobs. That's a whole other story, but I loved temping. But after I temped, I got a job teaching high school, and I taught for 3 years while Troy was trying to find himself. And he was doing a bunch of different jobs, and I remember he'd come home so frustrated. He was working at this place and he just hated it, and he'd come home every day and he'd sit on the couch and talk about, it's just hard when your husband or wife are doing something they don't like. And I used to say, you'd be so good at sales if you found something you really believed in. And at that time, really, neither one of us had any idea what we would be doing now, because that's true. I didn't realize that I would be the thing he believed in.
It comes in small inspirations. It brings redemption to life and the world, to our lives and our world. It comes in loving.
What's your first name?
Megan.
Hi, Megan. Nice to meet you. I like your braces.
Thank you.
Can I have
the show?
Yeah, I'd love to. What's your first name?
Marcus.
Hi, Marcus.
Laura.
Okay, L-A-U-R-A?
Correct.
Okay. I am Mother's Day weekend. I'll be back. Yep.
Is it tough with your kids traveling around here?
No, actually, with them is great. It's tough when I have to travel without them.
Yeah. I remember the first time our assistant had the idea that Kirby introduce us. He was 3 years old, and I'll never forget that night. It was a traditional stage. We were behind the curtain, and we were both kind of squatted down on the floor. And he said, "Mommy." And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "I'm so excited." And I said, "Yeah, I'm excited too." And then we waited, and he said, "Mama." I said, "Yeah." He said, "I have to go poopy." I said, "Can you wait just a minute?" And then the announcer said, "Kirby Groves." And he was 3 years old, and he bounded, I mean, like, much like Tigger, or I don't know a better analogy, but he bounded out to the middle of the stage.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing from Minneapolis, Minnesota, Sara Groves!
From that point on, that was his place. That's his spot, you know. And so everybody has a purpose on the road. Our little road family, and you know, even my father-in-law is driving the bus. He just retired from his job, and what a blessing, you know, that instead of fighting it and feeling bad about what I'm not doing, I'm embracing what I am doing, and it's been day and night. My attitude's been so much different. So it's fun. It's fun now, both the boys and produce, and, you know, I mean, we still have our moments. The boys still fight. Troy and I still don't see eye to eye on things, but overall, I would say, for what we sacrifice being on the road, we definitely get back in other incredible experiences and time.
Katrina, or?
Yeah, we are. I don't know. Paul put out an email this morning. We had a meeting yesterday to try to figure out exactly what we're going to do. Right now, we're just directing people to our website, talking about
money for sure right now.
We talked about, you know, what do you do a few months down the road.
Exactly.
Yeah. Think about all these
diapers, water.
Right. Yeah. Keep us in mind.
Because we're focus on
babies or
bottle water.
We've got the bays, and we could fill the interior of the bus, you know, with stuff and make it a thing where people come and fill the tour bus.
I kind of like that idea of focusing on a certain aspect, like the kids, you know, like the babies.
Yeah,
okay,
right.
So let's
right.
load our bus up with diapers, formula, and bottled water, and maybe. Toys, but like wipes,
blankets,
blankets, that kind of stuff. Let's see if we can. I don't know.
Yeah.
Our bus isn't the best cargo situation. It's got the bays.
Right.
It's got the alleyway.
The box.
Thank you.
Have you ever been on a helicopter? I saved this from the airplane flight over for moments like this. Is he writing his name?
From here, we're going to stand.
It was incredible to watch Gary Haugen. Gary's the kind of person that makes people feel their worth. 100 school kids came pouring out, surrounding us. And I see Gary, and he's down on his knee, and he's got his notepad and a pen, and he's asking a child to write his name because he's a school child. He's a third grader. And so while I'm kind of, this is foreign to me, I'm in a sea of African children, Gary is, it seemed to me that he was looking at this boy and saying, "You're a third grader."
Can you run that?
Amakui.
Amakui? Amakui?
Amakui? Amakui?
Amakui?
Amazuru.
Amazuru. Okay. Ai.
Amazuru.
Ai. In Kenya, Rwanda.
It's our first load.
This is our first load of goods for our
diapers.
Hurricane Katrina relief bus for babies.
Nice.
And we're excited to go down and hopefully bring a full bus of diapers.
Kinko's was nice enough to donate this sign to us for our expedition.
And we'll be in the parking lot of church tomorrow, and we got to announce at church on Sunday morning. Pastor was kind enough to let us speak.
Well, this week has been quite a week for our nation, hasn't it? With the hurricane that's occurred and the tremendous aftermath of that, we've been inundated by calls about how can we help. And certainly there are a lot of things over the media of ways in which you can help in a financial matter. One has to do with Sara Groves, and Sara will be here in just a moment to put a very personal Cedar Valley face onto a response to the hurricane. Sara, tell us about what you're going to be involved with.
I put down a book about 2 weeks ago. It's about Christian action. And at the end, the author says, "When disasters happen, I've ceased to ask, where is God? And I've begun to ask, where are God's people?" And it so moved me when I put that book down. I said to myself about a week and a half ago, I said, the next time I find my neighbor beaten and on the side of the street, I want to run, not walk, to his or her aid. So Troy and I would like to send a message from this church. I know that you're very generous, and we have a tour bus so we would love to fill. We've heard a call from friends of ours and different people for diapers, formula, and wipes, those three things specifically. And what we would like to do is on Tuesday morning at 7 a.m., we'll have our tour bus parked here at the church. We'd love to fill the bus to the rafters and take a message to say, there's a church in Minnesota that cares about you. Mother Teresa says, one of my favorite quotes, "You can do no great things, only small things with great love." And this is just a very small drop in the ocean. Thank you.
Thank you, Sara.
Hopefully people will come out and donate diapers. We've heard lots of calls for that specific need. We don't really even know where we're going because it's hard to make contacts right now. The communication networks are all down or busy, and so we're just going to go. We leave tonight at 7 o'clock. We're going to be collecting diapers, wipes, and formula. From this morning, I'm so encouraged. We already have one bay, it's halfway full.
Did your name?
My name's Rachel Bolte.
Okay, and you're here to donate?
I am.
Great.
Just like you were, thank you.
What?
Just an hour and a half. We already filled one bay completely full.
Awesome.
Move on to bay number two and keep going and then start filling the inside of the bus. It's awesome.
So, Father, I thank you for Sara and for Troy and for the burden you laid on their heart and the response they're able to have of it. So, Lord, I pray that you just pack that bus full and that your ministry, your hands and feet would be upon it as they go and serve you in this wonderful way. We ask in your name.
Hey, it's Zach the drummer.
Instead of getting our wedding party gifts, like gift certificates or whatever, we just took that money and got baby supplies. And so they'll get a card and know that a gift was given in their honor.
Very cool.
That's what we're doing.
Awesome. We've got a trailer being donated to us as we speak, and we're going to fill it as much as we can and head south. It's like 12 cars on the parking lot.
Yeah, we just had an influx of people after lunch, and it's awesome. Just got
a trailer.
Last night I wondered if this was a silly idea.
It's not my MO to do that kind of thing, you know, but it was my first taste of, you have an idea, you just do it. You just go do the thing.
I looked back and the left tire was on fire. Sparks coming out everywhere. And so I stopped it as quick as I could because I was on a bridge. I was concerned about the, I couldn't pull off at a bridge. So as soon as I got there, to the right bridge on the pass, I stopped the bus trailer and fire started popping out of the left side, so I got the fire extinguisher right away and put out the fire, and everything's okay.
Something changed, or you want to do
something changed? Will be easier. It's going to be all right. We'll be a little bit more complex. This is the answer to "Like a Skin," if you guys remember from the last album.
Oh, yeah.
Asking the question, can people really change? And then this is sort of the answer to that. That song.
I think that the challenge is going to be being tastefully elegant with this one, and just and not letting it grow out of control. So.
It's always a challenge to make it different from all the others. You want each song to kind of have its own personality and service what the lyric is.
Hey. What are you doing?
So, how's the blanket coming?
Good. Making a blanket for Kirby's bed. And it's coming. I did this much this week, all the green. So, it's going to have lots of colors on it, blue and purple and everything. And I miss those boys. I'm not usually away from them. And we decided this time that they'd be with my mom this week. So, I'm keeping them alive in my heart by making them a blanket.
Something changed inside me. Broke wide open, all spilled out. Till I had no doubt that something changed.
Well, the music always reflects what I'm learning. And so here I was having all these conversations with people. A lot of people are sort of disenfranchised with church, maybe, and there's been a lot of conversations. I've been in part of a lot of conversations, different people analyzing, you know, there's emergent church, there are worship wars, there's all this stuff going on. And there's a lot of cynicism and a lot of hurt. You know, people are inevitably get hurt in families and churches and different places. And so Add to the Beauty was sort of me emerging from my own place of sort of cynical heart and sort of always sorting everything, you know, and trying to make judgments about everybody. And, you know, I just, after a while, it just wears you out. So instead of wasting my time making all these judgments and how things should be, maybe I should think about adding to the beauty with my life and my time, my family, my marriage, and let that be a protest of beauty, you know, in a chaotic world.
Well, we're here in Arkansas. I'm not actually sure. We're at a church called Harvest something. And they have a truck going to Baton Rouge. In our trailer, we blew a tire this morning, and it's got a little bit too much weight. We overpacked it probably to the ceiling, and we're going to relieve some of our heavier goods like the sanitizer, the big heavy boxes, and put that on this truck that's going to Baton Rouge as well. And then continue to make our way to Louisiana. So that's where we are. So we're going to get to work.
That's a little stone, that's a little mortar, that's a little sis, that's a little water in the hearts of the sons and daughters. This kingdom's coming. It's a little stone, it's a little bit of mortar, it's a little bit of seed, it's a little bit of water in your hearts, in our hearts. This kingdom's coming. It's a little bit of stone, it's a little bit of mortar, it's a little bit of seed and water in our hearts. This kingdom is coming.
Let me know if we should stop on that trailer, because I don't want to empty it. It's okay. Got to be able to carry a couple hundred pounds.
Yeah, we're done.
Okay, good. Close her up.
Father-in-law was reading something to me the other day. I think it was Kierkegaard. I don't know if I said that right. But he was saying, people ask him, should we give all our money to the poor? And he said, no, you should seek the kingdom of God. And they said, should we go to the ends of the earth and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ? And he said, no, you should seek the kingdom of God. And he keeps making this point over and over again. I mean, that's the amazing thing about it, is that my marching orders are not going to be anybody else's marching orders. We each have the opportunity to have a path our own, that's our own, and a purpose that's our own. What an incredible gift. And it's just this small thing that God puts right in front of us to do, you know? My favorite quote, and it's on the cover of our new album, but Mother Teresa says, you can do no great things, only small things with great love. She just went out, literally walked down the streets every day and prayed that she would be able to perceive the need. And look what she did in just doing that, just walking down the street and asking to be able to perceive the need. We'll be right back.
trying to recreate a crime scene, you're trying to recreate the crime. You're trying to understand what precisely happened. And to try to put in your mind precisely what happened here is emotionally sort of overwhelming. And then when you get it out of the story of these kids.
This year we've had the opportunity to get to know Gary Haugen, who is the president of International Justice Mission. I first got to know him through his book, Terrify No More, which describes the work of International Justice Mission. They are a team of lawyers and law professionals, and they work to, using the laws that are already on the books in a certain country, to free people who are either in bonded slavery or who are part of human trafficking, sex trafficking. And so a lot of times they're saving girls out of these brothels. They don't just want to save the girl from the brothel, though. They want to shut the brothel down so that they don't go out and kidnap more girls. But it's just an incredible organization where, again, using the gifts that they have as lawyers and law professionals, they are making an impact in freeing slaves around the world.
And so there was this one little girl who would lay amongst the dead for 2.5 days, because sometimes, of course, they would, not everyone would die, and they would come back the next day and see who was moaning, and not even necessarily kill them off, just sort of inflict a little more pain and then come away the next day. So it was just very sadistic. And so this little girl had managed to stay quiet. There was a man who had almost smothered her trying to keep her quiet. What I just remember thinking was that the maker of the entire universe had specifically intended that this one little 8-year-old Rwandan girl should exist. While he's making everything else, at some point he very intentionally says, "I'd like to make this little 8-year-old Rwandan girl," and made her so that he could be with her forever, and wanted to be with her so badly that he was willing to give up his son to die for her. So that's the cosmic significance of this little girl in front of me, and yet she's got these big pink scars across the back of her neck and her head. And after spending a whole day in a mass grave of 5,000 or 6,000 people, you sort of lose a sense of humanity of these people. They had been in a fairly deep grave, so the flesh was still on them, so you could still see like humans. But you see the beauty of this one little girl and realize, well, that's what that big pile of carnage is. It's all these other people who are just as precious to God as this one, and yet hundreds of thousands of them just drop off the face of the earth, and for me as an American Christian, it just doesn't affect my day at all. And I think that was one of the points where, after spending day after day after day in masses of dead people, which sort of inures you to the beauty of the actual life, connecting with that little girl just made it very human. And then we went over and did the stadium the next day, and it was my last mass grave. And then, like within 78 hours, I was back in the United States on a bus back to work. And it was like you had gone to a different planet.
It's one thing to see somebody walking down a road less traveled, and something completely different to see somebody led by the Spirit making their own road. And that's what we've seen Gary Haugen doing. He's off making his own Gary Haugen road. And it's very inspiring. You think you're kind of doing, taking the road less traveled, and then you see somebody like him cutting a new road, and it's just very inspiring.
No, really, yeah.
Bye.
We're staying here.
Oh, you are?
We are, yeah.
At the end of his book, Gary Haugen says, "In times of great disaster and trial, I used to ask, where is God? But now my plea has changed. Instead of asking, where is God, I've begun to ask, where are God's people?"
I have lots of new things to chew on and to work with, but it's been incredible. I'd love sometime to hear, I've heard just little bits about what this trip meant to you, and I don't know if you'll ever write that down or somehow look back on that, but it's been a...
Look forward to show processing it myself.
Yeah.
Okay, here we go.
It's been incredible to hear you. And just your commentary and things on we love what you do with IJM, and I can't wait to see what happens with Rwanda with your office here. And I saw you make a beeline for the ambassador, so I imagine you met a lot of people. And
thanks for making the music that allows the heart to speak to them in a way that just words don't do. So.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Bye. Bye, Gary. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye, sir.
Bye, cameras. Exactly where we're going, because the lines are down and we've not really been able to contact anyone directly, but we've heard from friends who know people working at this Church Joy Fellowship that they've become sort of a hub for goods for people in the area that want to come and get resources. So hopefully we're going to the right spot, or they'll direct us somewhere else, and we'll just play it by ear today and go where we're needed.
Tell you, we evacuated our house on Sunday, and we got to Laurel, Mississippi, and we wrote it out there as a category 3, and I mean, it was destructive there, so we knew this town was in bad shape. Yeah. We knew this town. And I told my wife, I said, Leslie, if this is what it did as a 3, imagine what our town looks like. Is this another one coming in? It's a little trailer. Look at this.
Just
somebody did this out of the goodness of their heart. This isn't a big organization. If you look at it, it's got the names of the children who...
Yeah.
And, this is the kind of stuff... I'm sorry, guys.
No, man.
I've been doing this since...
Monday. Oh, I can't imagine how tired you are, Pastor.
And,
I can't even fathom.
It's wonderful, though. It really is.
Yeah.
In the midst of all this, like I said, I mean, you never understand how much people appreciate things.
Show me a love that never fails, some compassion and attention amidst confusion and dissension, like small ramparts. The soul, how it matters, like a single cup of water, how it matters.
We got it empty. A lot of help, a lot of people down here from all over the country, Virginia Beach and
Indianapolis. Minneapolis, we ran into some guys here from Minneapolis, unbelievable. This guy's working hard. All these guys, troops deployed from Virginia Beach. Here, they had no idea where to go, they had no contact, they just came. And everyone sort of started coming to this point. And we just got lucky enough to bump into them here. So thank the Lord. He knew where he was sending us. We didn't know where we were going, but he knew.
We're doing great. I just wanted to call in and let you know that we've had an unbelievable day. And for all the people that showed up and dropped off diapers and formula, I tell you, we pulled into Slidell, Louisiana this morning. And Slidell is a northern suburb of New Orleans. And their warehouse, distribution warehouse, was close to empty. And it was a complete divine appointment with this group of people here.
One of my life verse is Isaiah 41:9-10. And the reason I love it so much is because the onus is on God. He's saying, I took you from the ends of the earth, from its farthest corners I called you. I have chosen you and said you are my servant. I have not rejected you. I've said you are my servant. So do not be afraid, for I am your God. Do not be dismayed, for I will hold you up with my righteous right hand. And that was what we saw. You know, it was just a bunch of people called from the ends of the earth, from all over the country. Not any one of us really doing the whole thing, just each of us doing our part. And the onus is God's. He was, there's no way in light of what we witnessed in Louisiana that I could say there isn't a greater plan or that God isn't ordering our steps. And it's just incredible to get to witness those things in real time.
Which one? A Sabbath. Yeah. That's all we can do. Okay. Is the Sabbath.
So you're taking care of four babies right now?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, well, we got a brand new one in the hospital.
Is that right?
That's, so it's five of them.
Just yesterday.
Yesterday.
We came down with diapers, so we just...
Formula, diapers.
You just don't know how much this means to us. You know, you hear of all these other places always being disastered in Florida and all, and we don't know how they survive.
Thank you. There's so many people from our hometown that love you and want to respond, and they don't know what to do, so this is just the smallest thing that we can do, the smallest thing.
It's so hard with children. I don't know how these people are doing it with children.
It's gonna be all right.
She's great. She just wanted to be out of her car.
It's gonna be
all right. Oh. Jesus.
We're gonna be.
Yes, you are so sweet.
So her grandma just picked up diapers. She just has a brand new sibling. I don't even know a brother or sister.
I just have nothing. We went driving through neighborhoods that are absolutely devastated. They have nothing.
Big help.
Oh, what amazing people.
Yeah. Unbelievable.
I wish I spoke Rwandese.
So this is my first time to Africa, and I think that the only information that I ever had was from the media and different television sources and my interactions with World Vision and things like that. And of course, one of my first thoughts is you can't generalize Africa. Africa is vast and is different as...
Sorry. You gotta find it first. Ms. Didi.
Okay.
Happy pay? Is that right? Happy pay? Minnesota with snow. You wouldn't know what snow is. White from the sky. What's the French word for snow? Huh?
Na neige. Africa is so vastly different from anything I expected in the sense that it's so complex and you can't sum anything up. You can't generalize, make any generalizations. The people here are as complex and as beautiful and as different as people in America or you can't summarize all Americans, that's for sure, in what they believe and where they've come from. So in the same way, you can't sum up Africa. I think this Rwanda is très beau, beautiful. It's beautiful. Beautiful is beau. Is beautiful beau?
Or belle.
Belle.
You know, belle is a feminine
belle.
Beauty.
Yeah. Yeah. Belle. I think for a lot of Americans, Africa is a very small little box. It is something to be, in a way, pitied, if that's not the right word. But there's a sense of... I don't know. Instead of coming and seeing that, I saw national pride, and I saw community, and I saw brilliant minds and dreamers, and I saw people with vision, and in a context that's so completely different than my own.
We're going to a memorial site, to a genocide memorial site, where 50,000 people were told they would be safe at a school, and they were killed.
I didn't want to go to Rwanda because I thought, if I go to Africa, then I'm going to see things, I'm going to know things, and I'm going to come home with a Rwanda-sized burden. On top of all my other burdens in my life, things that I carry, I'm going to come home with another thing to carry. And instead, I went to Rwanda and my whole life was put in perspective in a way that was sorely needed, first of all. It wasn't a burden at all. I've never felt so fully alive as when I was in Rwanda. And I've never felt so grateful that God keeps teaching me at all. That he keeps taking the time and the energy to keep showing me things.
There were just a handful of survivors, and those survivors run the memorial center. And I don't really know what to expect. I don't really know what it is.
I don't have any photos of my family. I couldn't find any souvenirs of my parents or of my brothers and sisters.
I like volleyball and films. These two things give me courage. I also like to read autobiographical books about people who have suffered in their lives. It is a consolation to me. Prayer is also important to me. Bernard, 16. The killers should be put away where I'll never have to see them again. Life imprisonment would do, just as long as I never have to come across them somewhere. Looking after their children after they took away our parents who brought us up so lovingly. Chantal, 11. In my search for a hideout, I found Jerome, his legs cut off. I could not leave him in this state. I tried to lift up Jerome so that we could leave together, but the car of the commune stopped near me. It was full of machetes and other instruments of death. I laid Jerome down on the ground and ran because a man got out of the burgomaster's car to kill me. He finished Jerome off. I saw this when I looked back to see if anyone had followed me. I will never forget the way Jerome's face was filled with desperation. Whenever I think about it, I cry all day long.
Bonjour.
Bonjour. I'm just not... I know, I just don't know. To breathe, it's hard to breathe.
Bonjour. He took the children in the putting the massacres.
Alive?
Alive. Let's see there.
Right here?
Yeah, but here and there. The children.
You are one of the ten that escaped. He's one of the ten. He just showed me the bullet in his head.
I do. Bless you. What do you say? I don't even know. What do you say?
I was 11 when I went to Dachau, and I don't think I could process what was going on. I was seeing a lot of pictures and images of very gaunt and abused people, but I don't think I could understand. I remember I was 11 years old, and I walked into one of the main rooms, and they had a pile of shoes there, and sometimes it takes seeing numbers or something, I don't know, for it to sink in what I was seeing. I remember that was the moment when I sort of understood the vastness of it. I think here what is communicating that to me is that we saw 100 to 200 bodies, and that represents a million people. It's just really hard to process a million people. Your shirt says Brooklyn.
It says Brooklyn.
Brooklyn.
Brooklyn, that's what that says. Brooklyn.
Brooklyn.
Yeah, it's a place in America.
America.
Uh-huh. Brooklyn is America.
Brooklyn is America.
Uh-huh. Brooklyn.
Journey has been reflected in my music, but a couple of years ago I was in a season where I was just really scared. Everything seemed overwhelming to me with young kids introducing these very innocent babies to a very sharp, menacing, chaotic world. And I was just kind of hugging the wall, you know, just feeling like we'll just kind of make it through. And I guess what's happened in the last couple of years is it's just not enough. It's not enough for me. I just feel like when it's all over, that's not what I want to have shown my kids. I don't want my kids to watch me hug the wall. I want my kids to see me just like running with my head thrown back, you know? And I want the wick to be gone. I want the wax to be gone. I want to have burned down to the ground when this whole story is over, when my story is over.
And we're at dinner with the president. Last night we got to watch the Rwandan ballet. The first song, the men come out and they dance, and the woman sitting next to me, who's the Ministry of Cooperation, she said, this song is about the men and how they work and they protect their families and they provide for their families. And then the women came out and danced, and she said, this is about the women and their desire to be beautiful and graceful and to take care of the children. And then she said, this song is celebrating the children, and she said many Rwandan songs are about celebrating the children, and the song says to the children, you are as big to us as elephants. You are not a small thing that we don't see. You are big and mighty to us, and you're always in front of us, this big thing. And she said to me, mostly Rwandan songs are about life and children and work and play. And then she said, what is your music about? And I said, my music is about life and children and music and play. And it was just a neat moment.
Redemption comes in strange places, small spaces, calling out the best of who we are. And I want to add to the beauty. I want to tell a better story. Oh, shine with the light that's burning up inside. Whoa, 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 whoa. And this is grace, an invitation to be beautiful. And this is grace, an invitation. Redemption comes in strange places, small spaces, calling out our best. And now I